Hi, Barry. I'm Dan McCarthy from the American Conservative Magazine. How are you doing?
I'm doing well. How are you?
Not too bad at all. So, Barry, of course, is the author of a new book called Restraint, A New Foundation for U.S. Grand Strategy. And Barry, of course, is also a professor at MIT. So, Barry, tell us a little bit about Restraint. What is it, and why does America need it?
Well, I wrote this book in reaction to what I see as the excesses of post-Cold War U.S. grand strategy. One of the oddities of the post-Cold War period is how often the United States has been at war, and this seems a bit odd to me, given that the United States is also about as secure as it's ever been. So my suspicion was that something had gone wrong, and the more I looked into it, the more problems I saw. So I basically tried to craft a grand strategy that was more attentive to basic U.S. national interests, more sensitive to the costs and risks of using force, a little bit more concerned about the scarcity of resources at home, and attentive to the powerful kinds of identity politics that are out there in the world that seem to be a stumbling block to the Americans working their will in other countries, and particularly identity politics, talking about nationalism and religion and other things, many of which have come back to hurt us a few times. But at the same time, when we reach out and try and intervene in foreign states in order to change their politics in the hopes of banishing these passions, it usually turns out we just generate more passions. So we need some more discriminative way to deal with that problem.
What do you use as the criteria for discriminating? What are our true national interests, and what kind of grand strategy is necessary to address them?
Well, I always start from the base national security position of the United States, which I define national security fairly narrowly. It's about managing the possible threats to American sovereignty and territorial integrity, also to national safety and to the power position needed to pursue these interests. And I like to start out with America's basic national security position, which helps us put all proposed threats into some kind of perspective. The United States is still the richest country in the world, even given the growth of the Chinese economy and the growth of some of the other economies. The United States is still going to be one of the top two or three economies in the world for as far as we can see. Qualitatively, it would probably be the preferred economy. We live here in North America, which is a great continent. Many of our natural resources we need are here. We don't really have to trade for them. We have a very large and relatively youthful population compared to much of the rest of the world, with a nice demographic balance. We have oceans to the right and left, relatively weak and pliant neighbors to the north and south, fantastic military. And we're a nuclear weapons state, and it's not easy to really coerce or invade or do anything of that kind to a nuclear weapons state. So when you add all this up, the United States is an immensely capable state and immensely secure. Now, of course, when you have all this kind of power, it's tempting to go out into the wider world and try and reform the world in your image. But it's not really necessary to do that for U.S. national security. So then I try and ask, well, what does concern me in this environment? And I do have three concerns. One is the historical problem that the United States has tried to prevent, which would be the rise of a hegemonic power that would be able to straddle the Eurasian landmass and consolidate those resources and limit the American United States' ability to even secure itself, much less prosper. Right? So that would be a threat to us, and the Americans opposed it in World War II against the Nazis, and opposed it during the Cold War with the possibility of successful Soviet expansion. This was a reasonable thing to do, and if such a candidate hegemon were ever to emerge, it would still be reasonable for the United States to oppose it. Now, mostly these days, we concern ourselves with the rise of China, and we should be concerned. China's GDP is growing fairly quickly, and it has a big population base upon which to build. And it has sharp elbows, so in the future, China could be a threat. Presently, it's just a problem. But if it becomes a threat, and I think, we have to watch it to try and figure out when that moment is, the United States may have to engage in some fairly significant kinds of balancing. And it won't be easy if it comes, because if China does become a real problem for us, it's going to be, I think, in some ways a tougher competitor than the Soviet Union was, simply because it's a much more dynamic economy than the Soviet Union ever had. So that's one threat, and we should be prepared to balance against it if we must. But in the meantime, what we should be trying to do is get the allies we have in Asia, many of whom are rich, to do more to get ready, just in case China does become a threat. One of the pernicious qualities of our national security strategy, we spent so much time reassuring other countries that they actually don't do that much in their own defense. The Japanese spend 1% of GDP, we spent 3.5% or 4%, our European allies spend 1.5%. These countries are quick to come to us and tell us they feel insecure, but they're rich countries. And our response should be, if you feel insecure, do something, do more. You could do more. And you'd have to do a lot more to make yourself secure. Just do some more. So that's, we have to keep a weather eye on the Chinese, but there are lots of things that, we should do now, just in case, and we may need to do more later. But we also have to share the burden, and I think there are other countries out there we can share it with if the time ever comes. But we should be doing some things to get those countries ready now instead of babying them, which is what we do. And there's two other problems, one's of a more ecological variety, which is nuclear weapons exist in the world. Now, I said earlier that I think nuclear deterrence is a great force for American national security, but if nuclear weapons were to fall into the hands of groups that have no stakes against which the Americans can retaliate, groups who may not be rational, as we understand it, then there could be an important threat to the safety of American people. Not multiple nuclear explosions, but one in the wrong, would be a terrible thing. So how do we deal with this? Well, the usual American response has been to try and prevent all new nuclear weapon states from emerging anywhere, because the notion is that with each new nuclear weapon state, the odds of a mistake go up. And there's some truth in that, but it's awfully costly to try and prevent the rise of new nuclear weapon states. I mean, we have 9 in the world today, if you count the North Koreans, and, in all probability, there will at some point be more. Right, so what's our real interest here is to ensure that nuclear weapons remain in the hands of states who can be deterred and not fall into the hands of independent groups who may not be deterrable. And that means cooperation with other states that have nuclear weapons, even states that we may not like, to ensure that they have best practices for keeping the weapons secure and safe, and best practices for controlling their weapons in crisis to avoid accidental nuclear war, and things of that nature. So that's a kind of a different way of thinking about the American nuclear proliferation agenda from what we ordinarily hear, which is about prevention, 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 or rollback. And of course, when you think about prevention, countries who want nuclear weapons often want them for their security. And, prevention could imply preventive war. I mean, ostensibly, that was one of the reasons why the United States invaded Iraq and 2003 was concerned that they may someday have a working weapon of mass destruction and that we could somehow stop it with war. This is the logic that's also on the table in our discussions about what to do about Iran. And when the president says all options are on the table, what he means is there's a war option on the table. And this is what many of his critics mean. We should have to have a war option on the table. Well, it's an expensive way to deal with nuclear non-proliferation, but nuclear proliferation, especially when we're talking about a state that has a lot to lose by using nuclear weapons, a state that I believe can be deterred. Right? So that's the second problem is nuclear proliferation. What's a reasonable, prudent way to deal with it? It doesn't mean that all proliferation is good. It doesn't mean the Americans should do what they can to slow proliferation. The big questions will arise when you have to decide whether or not you're going to wage a preventive war to keep a state from getting nuclear weapons. My point is that based upon the preventive wars that we've fought in recent years, this is not likely to prove a good solution, an enduring solution, an affordable solution. And the final problem is an aligned problem, which is the problem of terror. And, it's not terror as a tactic. I mean, all kinds of political groups use terror. But, you know, we've seen at least once in our own sad case, the 9/11 case, that there are occasionally going to be groups that have really big goals and are willing to engage in all kinds of very extreme violence to get them. And we need to be concerned that such groups may target the United States. And we need to do things to try and keep that from happening. And, you know, we've done many, many things on the defensive side since 9/11 to harden up the United States. We've done many, many things on the offensive side. We collect vast amounts of information on potential adversaries. We hunt them around the world. We cooperate with other security institutions, other countries, police and intelligence organizations to do that. And most of this is prudent, you know, prudent defensive action. The real question arises is when, you know, analogous to the proliferation question, is when do you need to go out and invade countries to try and fix it so that terrorist groups cannot flourish there, cannot be based there. And this is, you know, this is a big question. You know, our record on invading countries and reorganizing their politics isn't all that great. It's easier to knock over a government than it is to replace it. And if you, you know, if you turn an autocratic state into a bloody civil war, have you really improved your situation, right? And if you then have to stay in that bloody civil war on an open-ended basis, have you improved your situation? The tactics you need to resort to tame the different forces in a bloody civil war actually eliminate the political sources of violence against you, or do they feed those sources? I don't think our record's very good, so my view about dealing with terror is that defense is a lot more important than offense. And when you go on the offense, it should be of the targeted, limited variety and not the invade countries and reorganize their politics variety, which is, you know, what we practiced in Iraq and to some considerable extent in Afghanistan.
Well, and you make a very good point about how our anti-terror strategy and our strategy to contain nuclear proliferation, they have to kind of go together. And if we're going around destroying regimes, destroying states, we're actually making it harder in some ways to prevent, you know, established nuclear stockpiles from, you know, getting out of control and basically starting to proliferate into the hands of terrorist groups and becoming an actual danger. So it does seem that, you know, we have this, we'd be very well advised to maintain states, even states we don't necessarily like very much, that are nonetheless able to at least contain existing nuclear stockpiles, as opposed to trying to aim at a kind of political perfection, and in doing so, risk having states disintegrate and nuclear stockpiles wind up in unknown hands.
Well, there's a lot of, you know, complicated questions here. You know, proto-nuclear states or even nuclear weapon states that somehow came apart or whose disintegration you could somehow facilitate would immediately generate the dilemma of what you do about their nuclear weapons. Now, the counterproliferation people would say yes, and that's why you have to not let any other states get nuclear weapons, because every time there's a new state, there's a risk that if it disintegrates, nuclear weapons will be lost. That is that's a real dilemma, right? And it's quite hard to resolve the dilemma. I think you just have to think about, you know, different costs and different remedies that you could bring to bear, right? And then the second problem is when you knock over states, you may convince other states who also have some conflict of interest with you, but who may not have nuclear weapons, to scratch their head and say, "Gee, the real problem here is that state does not have nuclear weapons." You wouldn't see the Americans trying to invade a nuclear weapon state. It intensifies others' interest in getting nuclear weapons. So the only point here is that there's no free lunch. You know, you sort of have to decide where you want to, you know, accept your risks and costs. And one of the things that, I argue against in the book is the assumption that that war is somehow a surgical solution to problems, right? That if you invade a country and knock over the regime and try and install another one, that somehow this is going to be cheap, it's going to be easy, it's not going to take very much time, It's not going to produce negative externalities that themselves redound to your security disadvantage. There's all kinds of problems that arise when you try and use military power to achieve fine-grained outcomes. Military power is pretty good at swatting back aggressors. It's pretty good at throwing aggressors out of pieces of real estate that they've conquered, right? But it's not so easy a tool to use for reorganizing the politics of our country.
Well, that certainly is something that the American Conservative magazine has, had as one of our themes over the past 10 or 12 years. We were founded as conservatives who opposed President Bush's Iraq War, and the idea that these interventions are cost-free is something we've fought against and tried to really show is not the case, even before the costs became very obvious, as they certainly did over the course of many years in Iraq. But I wonder, the antithesis of restraint is liberal hegemony. And the liberal hegemonists, they might say, well, sure there are costs, but, it's all very speculative as to what's really the higher cost, right? U.S. intervention, which has certain known costs in terms of blood and treasure, or a lack of U.S. intervention, which has also, unknown costs in terms of threats, which may seem very small right now, but could ultimately grow into something much larger. And, the example they would always cite, of course, is the growth of fascist power between World War I and World War II. The idea that, well, if we had been willing to be a little more firm in the 1930s, we could have prevented something like World War II from happening. But it seems important to me, restraint is not about non-interventionism, however. I mean, it does say, we want our allies to bear more of the burden, but we do want to still have allies in the world. What is exactly the sort of overarching scope of U.S. security concerns if restraint is our grand strategy? What is it that we would say, well, we don't want to cut back this much. This much is going too far. It's clear that we don't want to be involved in a lot of nation building that we've seen in the past decade or so. But what's the other extreme? What would be too much non-intervention?
Well, people have different narratives about what happened in the 1930s and different notions about when it became obvious that a really firm stand was necessary. And there's a kind of a complex of problems that helped move us from the end of the First World War to the beginning of the Second. Now, we could have a long discussion about that. I guess what I argue in the book, which has an entire chapter devoted to the military strategy and military force structure of restraint, is that the U.S. should keep a comfortable margin of military capabilities to pursue the interests that I outlined earlier in our conversation. And the main thing that I think the United States needs to do in its military is ensure that it has privileged access to the rest of the world for purposes of using military power, not to invade, but to help others defend themselves. So our traditional interest in command of the sea remains very strong in restraint. The allied interest of command of the air and command of space remains very strong in restraint. Right, so the force structure that I generate talks a lot about keeping a very comfortable margin of military power in those domains, and talks particularly about the force structure and defense budget it takes to sustain it. So you end up with around 2.5% of GDP, and you end up with a very, very capable military. What you end up with is a much smaller ground force, right? So this is quite a lot of insurance against the possibility that some state abroad could become highly ambitious. And the second thing that I try and remind people, again, going back to our earlier conversation, is that the United States already has a lot of inherent insurance, right? And international politics, to coin a phrase developed in another realm, is not beanbag. And the United States is inherently a lot more secure than other countries. So when people tell us that if domino A falls, then dominoes B, C, D, E, F, G, H, I, J, K, up through Z will ultimately fall, and then the adversary will be at the gates, Well, I think our answer should be there are many, many dominoes that need to fall between domino A and the present, and there is no ineluctable connection from one domino to the next. And some dominoes are more worth defending than others, right? So the one people who argue for the liberal hegemony strategy have a premise of very high degree of interconnectedness among all issues of all types, right? And I challenge that interconnectedness, and I also challenge the speed with which one thing could lead to another, which would ultimately produce damage to the United States. Even given my challenges to all those premises, I still propose the United States maintain a very significant military capability. And this is not an isolationist strategy, but it is a strategy that treats alliances more like alliances. And, you know, one of the dark sides of international politics is that, you know, your allies are called allies. You know, politicians, when they're trying to explain things to American people, talk about our friends and allies. Well, it's they're allies, right? Which means that they're in it for their interests and we're in it for ours, right? It's not all for one and one for all, right? If it were, then we'd be one country. We're not one country. We're multiple countries. We have to think about our national interests first, right? And to be able to do that, we need to get our allies to do more. And to get our allies to do more, one of the peculiarities of the structure of the situation is we have to convince them that we might do less, or that we could do less, or that we could do without them. Right? Now, I don't think we need to go around bludgeoning them all the time with this fact, but we do need to return this fact to our regular diplomacy with our allies in order to remind them that they should be as interested in their security as they expect us to be interested in their security. And if they're not, we should start scratching our heads and ask ourselves, what kinds of allies are these really?
Well, and you've introduced a very important concept, I think, the idea of the dangerous driver. Can you explain that right fast?
Well, I call it the reckless driver, actually. It's even more poetical. Well, there's two kind of problems that America has with its allies, that all great powers have with their allies. One is cheap and free riding, and the other is reckless driving. And the cheap and free riding we've been talking about, which is, you know, in contrast to the usual arguments of the American foreign policy establishment, which is that our allies doubt our credibility. I don't think there's much evidence our allies doubt our credibility. If they doubt our credibility, they'd spend more on defense, right? They don't doubt our credibility. They have high confidence in the credibility of our commitments. We could do with a little less credibility, right? So, you know, Japan, if you're scared of what's happening in your region, spend a bit more than 1% of GDP on defense. And I say to the Europeans, if you're scared of the Russians, spend a little bit more than 1.5% of GDP on defense. You can do it. You're rich countries. When the Americans solve their security problems for them, it's welfare for the rich, right? We're reaching into our pockets to buy military power to defend states that are wealthy enough and capable enough to do way more in their own defense than they do. So I think cheap riding is a really big problem for us, mainly now, presently, it just costs us more money. But in the future, it could be an even bigger problem because you've gotten allies used to doing very little. And as the challenges grow, which I think they probably will because of the growth rates of the economies of other countries, we're going to need our allies to do more. And we should, you know, now while it's still a little bit quiet, we should be getting used to the idea. So that's something we should be doing. The other problem is, as you mentioned earlier, is the reckless drivers. And again, these are countries that have great confidence in the American embrace. I mean, they really trust us to be there for them. And they do things that, we have told them are inimical to our interests, and things which, you know, an objective observer might even decide is inimical to their interests, but some faction in their country wants to do it, right? So, we sponsored these two hapless regimes, Afghanistan, the Karzai regime, and in Iraq, the Maliki regime. We helped these regimes get resources. We helped stand them on their own two feet. We helped build militaries for them. We advised them. And we said, you know, it would be smarter if you did A, B, C, and D in your own defense, and they don't really do it. You know, the Afghan regime is corrupt as hell, has been for a long time. This is a problem that they should have done something about in their own interest. The Iraq regime was not only corrupt, it was unfair to the two principal minorities in the country, more unfair to the Sunni Arabs, than it was to the Kurds, but still unfair to both. And this wasn't intelligent from the point of view of keeping peace in that country after we left, right? But did they listen to our advice? No, they drove recklessly. So now we're dealing with the consequences of their reckless driving. Right? We have to go, you know, Americans have convinced themselves they have to go back in and defend defend Baghdad from the ISIL assault, right? And essentially we're defending a regime that created the problem in the first place. So it's, you know, there's a reckless driver for you. There are lots of minor examples of reckless driving. It would be better if Japanese senior political figures did not visit this so-called Yasukuni Shrine, which is a shrine to honor Japanese war dead. And we have our war dead, and we do like to honor them. But the unfortunate thing about Japanese war dead is that there's a good many people in the list of Japanese war dead who are also Japanese war criminals. And people in Asia remember this. And if Japan is to be a respected, trustworthy partner in Asia, then they can't be seen to be honoring dead war criminals. It's just not rational, right? And that's reckless driving from the point of view of Japan's security. And from the, and who has to pick up the slack for that? The Americans do, right? So, yeah, this is a good example. And, you know, we've had this long argument with the Israelis about the settlements on the, you know, in the occupied territories. We've argued that there should be a two-state solution, and Palestinians need to have a state. And different Israeli governments have, you know, sort of conceded the point, but they don't really want that Palestinian state to control all of, or even, you know, this gets technical, but even a reasonable share of the real estate in the West Bank. And the Israelis have basically, you know, allowed different Israeli political groups to acquire real estate and settle these areas. So the settlements policy makes it harder and harder to negotiate a two-state solution. And it antagonizes the Palestinians and antagonizes, to some extent, the rest of the Arab world, though that can be exaggerated. Right? And this is another form of reckless driving. There are many people in Israel who don't agree with this policy. But the Israeli government goes on with it, and the Americans basically wag their fingers, but it goes on. And we deal with some of the negative consequences of that in terms of our relations with the Arab world, in terms of propaganda points that are, you know, exploited by radical groups across the Arab world. This is a cost. So all these countries, they felt very secure. The Americans will look after them. The Americans will rescue them. The Americans will provide military assistance. The Americans will help in the United Nations, right? So we provide all this, insurance, and our commitments in some sense are banked, and our allies go forth and engage in, reckless driving that hurts them and hurts us.
Well, let's talk about a couple of present examples. So you mentioned ISIL or ISIS, the so-called Islamic State. And you've said in a recent interview with The Atlantic that, one restrained approach to terrorism is not to go and invade countries and try to democratize and set up kind of liberal political regimes, but rather simply to keep terrorist forces on their toes, to harass and harry them so that they can't really consolidate and plan and carry out attacks against the West. Is that the approach you would take towards ISIS or ISIL?
Yeah. I think the U.S. government has overpromised on what they intend to do. I'm not enough of a fortune teller or futurist to be able to know whether they can successfully do what they say they intend to do. But it seems quite difficult to me to imagine that we're going to somehow train sufficient capable forces in the region to go into the areas that ISIL has taken and eject them and then suppress them. If the Iraqi military had this capability, they wouldn't be in the spot they're in. If there were anybody in Syria who was strong enough to do this, they wouldn't really be in the spot that they're in. What seems to be the case is that groups and factions in the Middle East, whether they're Kurds or Shiite Arabs or Alawites, whatever they are, they fight hardest when they're fighting for their own turf, their own homes, their own areas of settlement, their own real estate. They don't seem to be that good at establishing order in among populations that are a little bit different from them. You know, I talked earlier about identity politics. This is a place where identity politics really seems to matter, right? So, you know, Shiite and Kurdish troops are not very good at maintaining security in Sunni Arab majority areas. They tend to make themselves disliked. They're mistrusted from the get-go, and then they're going to make themselves disliked. And they don't seem as committed to the fight in those areas as they are when you ask them to defend their own towns and villages, right? So, you know, you've got a couple things going against you, if that's your hope. And if you're, you know, using air power to try and actually weaken significantly a group like ISIL, it's pretty difficult because it's not an industrial power, right? They're embedded in the population. There's lots of ways they can hide and obscure themselves. So, yeah, there are some juicy targets worth, you know, maybe worth bombing, but in general, this is going to hit the flat part of the curve pretty soon. So my view is that, yes, ISIL looks like they could potentially be, you know, a source of terrorist actions, you know, organized ultimately against the United States. It could happen. It didn't seem to be high on their agenda before, but, you know, maybe. They certainly have sharp elbows and sharp teeth and, ideology that leads them to commit great violence, religious-based ideology, and they have big ambitions, and some of those ambitions impinge on interests of ours, and we should help shore up the defenses of those folk, right? So, you know, I didn't have any big objection to kind of providing some munitions to the Kurds, some advice, some intelligence, even a little air support. Even to the Shiites around Baghdad, I'd rather not have had a Shiite-majority Baghdad fall to, you know, fanatical Sunni Muslims. The political consequences would have been, you know, very great for the region. And the Shiites seem willing to fight for their own neighborhoods in Baghdad. They fought hard before, they'll fight now. So, yeah, some assistance there, sure. But, you know, moving back in the direction that of the areas that ISIL has taken, I'm much more dubious about that. And, you know, there are some areas on the border where they got lucky. They took places that really, you know, weren't Sunni majority areas. Maybe some of those you can nibble back. Yes, okay, fine. But this grandiose statement that ISIL is going to be eliminated and that we're going to produce an Iraqi army or Syrian rebel forces that are strong enough not only to, you know, to invade these areas or reconquer these areas or destroy ISIL's conventional fighting forces across a huge swath of Iraq and Syria with 6 or 8 million people living in it. This is a big job. And then to establish security in those areas, right? So you don't have to just knock ISIL's, you know, conventional organized ground forces out. All you're going to do then is drive them underground. Then you have to keep them suppressed, right? So there's a counterinsurgency that follows, right? These are big, big jobs. And I'm very skeptical that the Iraqi militaries or the Syrian rebels could be made able to do this. And in the course of doing it, the Americans kind of end up on the slippery slope. You know, you're bombing more because you're hoping to find juicy targets, and that means you're risking the deaths of civilians, which then generates propaganda for the other side. If you start counteroffensives and then they fail, you suffer another propaganda loss, and then you're tempted to double down and add more American advisors. If that doesn't do the trick, someone's going to say, add more ground forces or use more air power. So, you know, you're not just on the slippery slope. It's worse. It's, you know, I like to think of it as banana peels on the slippery slope. You're really making yourself a hostage to fortune with these kinds of promises. And if you try and launch these kinds of operations, given what we know about the region. So, you know, again, my first impulse is always, you know, contain, surround, surveil, harass, and try and force errors on the other side. You know, we know that ISIL's, you know, they make themselves unloved very quickly. Well, let's give them time to make themselves unloved. Let's uncover, you know, the true hideousness of this group. Let's make our own, you know, propaganda against them. Let's get the others in the region to really to engage themselves in serious propaganda to demonize ISIL and show how horrible they are. And, you know, if you know, as that begins to work, you may begin to see defections from the areas that they're in. You'll see rebellion. And you can maybe exploit that. And that takes time. But it's that kind of, you know, patient, you know, strategy that you need here, because if you try and do things, you know, the way we like to do them, which is, you know, get on top of the problem, go at them, you know, solve it, lance this boil, excise this cancer. I just think you're going to make it worse. I mean, it's, you know, this is what we've been doing. So we should, you know, if this strategy were successful, we shouldn't be having this conversation, right? So I just think we have to think of another way to deal with these problems.
Well, the restraint critique of the foreign policy we've had over the last 15 years or so is pretty clear. I wonder, though, what's the restrainer critique of the Clinton administration's foreign policy, especially as it relates to terrorism in the Middle East? Because there we saw, you know, a number of missile strikes in the Sudan, in Afghanistan. You know, we had occasional, you know, attacks elsewhere also. And that didn't seem to be enough to deter al-Qaeda or to prevent the 9/11 attacks. What would be the restrainer sort of riposte to this? What would be the better way of doing things?
Well, I don't think you deter terrorist attacks. I mean, deterrence means you threaten a value that the other guy has, right? So that the pain that he's going to suffer causes him not to want to try and inflict pain on you. But it's clear that the opposition here doesn't have much that you can threaten. So that the issue is not deterrence. The issue is some mixture of defense and offense. And so the question is, was the Clinton administration's mixture of defense and offense particularly wise? And I think in retrospect, we have to say that on the defensive side, they did too little. And on the offensive side, they probably did too little as well. Now, when people say they made strikes against Osama, these were pretty limited and sporadic, right? So I think they could have pursued those guys just a bit more aggressively. But at the same time, I don't think there's any case in retrospect to argue that the Clinton administration somehow should have invaded Afghanistan. I mean, this was not an intelligence strategy, in Iraq. And I think in the end, you were forced to do it after 9/11 in Afghanistan. And I think that had mostly to do with the fact that the Taliban regime had hosted al-Qaeda and needed to be punished. Now, and that's a case where I think deterrence could work, but I don't think any deterrence threat was leveled. In other words, when we knew that al-Qaeda was living in a Taliban-dominated state, that was a case where the Taliban themselves needed to be made to understand that if an attack originated in Afghanistan, that something really horrible was going to happen to Afghanistan and to them, right? And I don't believe such a threat was made. And if it was, and again, I could be wrong here, if it was, then there was something about the way the threat was made that made it not believable. Now, I don't think we suffer that problem now. I mean, the sad and tragic fact is that 9/11 happened, and it has consequences for how the Americans need to proceed, right? So on the defensive side, we did not do enough prior to 9/11, and we've done a great deal more since then, and that's reasonable. And on the offensive side, I think we did not do enough prior to 9/11, and I think some of the things that President Obama has tried to do, with targeted attacks on various actors, have at least has been intelligent in principle. Whether in practice, you know, there have been too many attacks, that's a reasonable question to ask. But the principle of keeping some kind of targeted offensive activity underway in order to backfoot people who may be plotting against you, I think, is right. The real question there is on how much. So I don't think it's, you know, intelligent or wise for people to argue in retrospect that the Clinton administration had it right. But at the same time, I don't think the fact of 9/11 tells you that some of the solutions that came after 9/11 were wise ones either. I think what we've learned is that this is not an easy problem, and you can do too little and you can do too much, and there are many things like that in life, and this is one of them, right? So you got to kind of make a judgment, and the judgment that I made, and I think a good many people who look at the specific problem we've made, is that you want to watch the adversary intently. You want to put barriers between the adversary and your country. And you want to keep enough pressure on the adversary that the adversary spends scarce resources evading you, rather that he then does not have to spend trying to get through your barriers. Right? That's, I think, the way to think about the problem.
Well, one of the points I take, I believe, from Jason Burke's book, The 9/11 Wars, is that we tend to think of our own power to punish and to deter, you know, states that may be dangerous. But in fact, you have to look at also the internal dynamics of some of these states. So in the case of Afghanistan, in the lead up to 9/11, the Taliban had to worry about the threat to their sort of Islamist right, so to speak. That basically, if the Taliban wasn't accommodating Al-Qaeda, their own more radical elements within society would have posed as big a threat to them, perhaps, as they saw the U.S. posing. So even though they certainly realized that the U.S. would retaliate for 9/11, they also had to just calculate that against the threats they were facing within their country, from their own allies, basically. So there are certain things that we just can't change, even if we do have overwhelming force on our side, that, there's a razor blade held against people's throats all around the world, not only the threat of sort of U.S. attacks, but also the threat that radical actors can pose to weak states like Afghanistan. It does seem to me that states are kind of the key here. I mean, states can be deterred, especially strong states that are stable, that have something to lose. Weak states like Afghanistan, which are themselves, at risk domestically as well as from the threat of, the blowback that their own terrorism would cause. Those are a lot harder to deter. So would one element of restraint be a view that the U.S. should use, certainly not military power, nation building's off the table perhaps, or something that's only a last resort, but should the U.S. be very concerned about basically stabilizing and strengthening states, all around the world, even places where, even states we may not particularly like, but that at least we can deal with state to state rather than dealing with more radical actors, stateless actors that may not be deterrable?
Well, in principle, I think the United States of America should be interested in strong states, but in practice, I'm just very dubious that we know much about how to cause that. And you can turn loose advisors or governance experts. You can add money to the mix, but it's pretty complex process. It's true that some states are too weak to control their internals, right? And in those cases, we have to pay extra attention to whatever groups are happening, are plotting or organizing in these places, and we may have to reach out and touch them ourselves. That's a sad fact. I'm a little skeptical that the Taliban was fearful of being outflanked on their right. There was a range of things they might have done to restrain Al Qaeda without expelling them from the country. The principal one being, just do do not implicate us in a major plot against the Americans, because they've made it clear that if such a plot originates here, they're going to come after us hammer and tongs. And, you know, for the same reason that we like having you here, which is you help us in our fights with the Northern Alliance. The Northern Alliance is there as a sword for the Americans to wield, and we don't want it wielded. Right now, maybe the Taliban was just not worldly enough to understand these things. They don't seem to have been an enormously worldly bunch in certain ways. But I think that's the best we can do, right? It's some combination of deterrence or coercion of regimes, defense of denial of ourselves, you know, access to Americas or to allies of ours, very intensive, you know, surveillance of potential groups, and the occasional wielding of, the sword, all the time with attention to the politics thereof, because, there is a dynamic which even senior American intelligence officials have understood, that doing too much in too many places too often creates new recruits for our enemies. And, you don't want to do that either. So it's a fine line you have to walk, and that's life in the world that we helped build.
Well, we should wrap up in just a minute or so, but I figure before we do, we might get in one more topic, and that is what's currently happening in Ukraine and Russia. What is the restrainer approach to that situation?
Well, I mean, the first thing I think to do is to ask the strategic question, and that is to put Crimea and then Donetsk and Luhansk into some kind of strategic perspective as far as whether it's it raises the threat to the United States or even raises Russian capabilities to threaten NATO, the treaty partners that we actually have made formal alliances with. And it doesn't, right? I mean, it doesn't have that effect. So then the kind of the more interesting question is, what does it say about Russian intentions? What does it say about Russian sensitivity to cost? What does it say about Russian willingness to pay costs to use certain kinds of means, right? And here it conveys some information, right? Russia's now a tougher competitor than it was 10 or 15 years ago, partly because of its modest economic recovery from the collapse of the Soviet Union, its modest military recovery, the fact that it has a government with a strong leader. You have to like him to admit that he's a strong leader, has quite a lot of support at home. The Americans got used to having a basically weak and supine Russia that more or less did what we asked. And those days are gone, and we should understand that they're gone. And our allies in NATO should understand the same. So what's necessary here? Well, we have to keep an eye on both Russian intentions and Russian capabilities. Now, Russian capabilities, though much greater than they were 10 years ago, are a shadow of what the Soviet Union had. And, there's not a lot of force protection capability there. Now, if they keep building and fixing and mending and everything else, then it will grow. But if and as it grows, the NATO-European allies should be asked to grow their military capabilities to stay current, because they have the economic wherewithal to do it. They have the military skills to do it. That's the basic way of looking at the problem. Now, Ukraine, it's not in NATO. I think it's good that we did not invite it into NATO, because it's a very hard country to defend. And it's a country that has its own, rather intense internal political disputes. It's part of the reasons why Luhansk and Donetsk have tried to secede, and Crimea as well, is they didn't really like the central government. There are big disputes between people in the east side of the country who tend to identify with Russia, and on the west side who tend to identify with the West. And that's helped make the country difficult to govern. So, this is not a was not then a good candidate for membership in NATO? Is it really a good candidate now for membership in NATO? And is it a necessary candidate? Right? And we have to understand that, you know, if you take a country into NATO, given that the United States is still a card-carrying member of this alliance, we're committing ourselves to defend it. So would you feel pretty good about defending Ukraine against the secession of motivated Russian nationalists in Luhansk and Donetsk and Crimea? Would you feel good about having nuclear crises with the Russians over this? Would you think that that was really a vital security interest in the United States, given everything I've said about our security position? Even the most ardent critics of Russia, even the ones who suggest the United States should do something militarily to aid Ukraine, they stop at after they've recommended sending to Ukraine some military equipment. They know we don't have any business in this fight. Now, does this mean I like what the Russians did? No. The United States should approve it, applaud it? No. Does it mean that countries in Europe don't have reason to perk up their ears and focus their eyesight and say, the Russian bear seems to be a little tougher than it's been in recent years? All prudent things to do, right? But this is not, on the basis of present evidence, the reemergence of a candidate hegemonic power in Western Europe. It's the emergence of a power, and the Americans have to get used to that. And as we look into the out years, what we're going to see is more and more countries with the wherewithal to assert themselves. So this is going to make this project, which is the consensus project, the American security elite, the liberal hegemonic project, more and more expensive. And you see evidence of the expense all the time. So we need to return to a much more judicious and focused calculation of our own national security interests. And channel our resources to that, and then accept that for other things we might like to do, we're going to have to engage in a whole bunch of gray area compromises that aren't going to make anyone feel really great. But if they make the world a little better off, then that's positive.
Okay, very good. Well, thank you, Barry. I certainly highly recommend your book, Restraint, to all of our listeners and viewers today. And I think we've covered a lot of good ground here. Hopefully the liberal hegemonists out there and the foreign policy establishment will at least pay attention and realize that there's a serious case to be made against them.
Well, so long as critics have a place to stand, that's all we can hope for.
Well, I hope for a little more. I hope that actually one of these days we'll get a true foreign policy of restraint. So thanks again, Barry.
You won't get it unless you ask for it. So thanks a lot.
Quite
good to be with you. Bye-bye.
Thanks. Bye.